every young person that I meet now, 20 some odd years later, I make sure they are introduced with this book, Bobby Wright's book, and a few others, but this, the reason why I gravitated so quickly to this book is because it's comprehensive. It's easy to understand. Years later, Baby Boy comes out. John Singleton uses some of the awesome anecdotes in his movie from the book. Higher Learning comes out. Ice Cube is quoting from the book. What was the movie? Boomerang. Even though they try to make him seem crazy while he was doing it, but you know how they do it in movies. Boomerang, he's on the pool table and he's trying the best he can to convince the other brothers that white supremacy is alive and well.
Yes, sir.
Martin Lawrence was doing. So after all this, I understood that if we didn't have a grasp on what racism, white supremacy was, we would get lost in the words. So sometimes we have to give, you know, book studies, have book clubs for further clarification. Because oftentimes, you know, when we read by ourselves, with not any, very little help at all, you know, again, we get kind of lost in the translation. But this book, again, it didn't just change my life. Changed my wife, how she looked at the world, how we see things now. I mean, even when I see a brother smoking a cigarette, smoking a cigar, you know, I instantly revert back to the book. Like, instantly, cigars, black limousines, anything has to do with something the sister said very profoundly in this piece. Then, and the first essay was written when, Doctor? Can I ask? 60, first essay?
1970.
Seven. And if we read it now, we see those same things evidenced today on the street. Something you said recently, I was listening, you said black men need guns and pit bulls. Right? I repeat that to my students in school now, you know, because that's what we see on the block. Men, pistols, and pit bulls. And obviously she'll do a better job describing those connections than I would, but I think it's important, man. You know, we just lost Steve Copley. Last Wednesday. We have to not just bring in these giants in, but we have to continue to support them. Because without a good and strong support system, like you's like, oh wow, I didn't know. We don't know. Now he's an ancestor. So let's do a better job, even myself, let's do a better job with continuing to support these giants because they stick their neck out for this type of information. You know, there's a lot of information out there. You've seen the bookstores, mainstream, watered down. Information doesn't pose a threat. Information like this poses a threat not just to the establishment, but to these house Negroes. Children, what if children understood the dynamics early of racism, white supremacy? Yeah. So when children come, nah, I've never experienced racism. What does that mean? They don't know what racism, white supremacy, even adults say, oh man, I never experienced that. I don't even know what that means. Because they don't have a concrete idea on what it is. Right. So, before I bring the sister up, and secondly, you know, I'm 42 years old, so me being in awe of anyone, I just want to say that right now, you know. It's not regular. I've seen the lecture one time, 1995 at Kennedy King, if I'm not mistaken. 95, once. But when you read someone, it's like you know them. So I'm telling my son, yeah, when you see the sister, make sure you do boom, 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 boom. Seeing her on the street coming upstairs, I forgot everything. But it's cool. But it's cool because hopefully we'll have time to chat. I want to go over some things with her. Some of the parts in the book like made more sense to me than others, but the parts that didn't make sense, once I saw the examples of it, it became clear as day to me. So, next point, we have pyramid visuals. In the back, we're gonna take a break at 5:30. And I want the people here to support pyramid visuals. They sell t-shirts, accessories. And we have a sister out here doing a tasting for Serenity. Natural coffee and teas. That'd be good if you kind of checked her out. Food will be served. We're gonna start serving food at 5:00. That's outside. We have more of a variety that we usually have. So you're gonna check that out at 5:30 when we break. So without any further ado, I want to give Dr.Frances Welsh, Cress Theory of Confrontation, a nice after round of applause.
He's just one example of what continues to happen to us as a people.
Yes.
And to the people in Tulsa, Oklahoma, the five black men who were shot.
Mm-hmm.
And Trayvon Martin's life was given in a sense to really wake us up. You see, sometimes it's one case that really brings attention. And, you know, I know it wasn't intended by Zimmerman to make this contribution to us as a people, but we needed to be awakened. We needed to be brought out of the post-racial sleep. The black president sleep. Now that we have a black president, everything is supposed to be fine. So, you know, I'm looking at this schedule. I got 1 hour and 15 minutes to start. I'd like to have 3 hours now. But let me begin. And I want to talk about what we need to do in terms of the maximal development of our children in the system of racism. And what we see coming down the pipe, I mean, it makes me very, very nervous what is going on now. And stand your ground. I don't know how much people are talking about it here, but in D.C. we have Joe Madison on FCN Radio and Al Sharpton, they're on every day talking about all of the things that happened. Everybody needs to get FCN Radio so that they can hear some of these programs where black people are talking all over the country and expressing their views. You know, people calling in and saying what's going on in their area and saying what they're thinking about. But let me start in this way. I started thinking about racism. Well, first of all, I'm a Chicagoan, born at Providence Hospital, Winfield High School, Douglas Elementary. And my parents were very political, always focusing us or, you know, go hear Dr. Du Bois so you can see how old we are. Go hear Du Bois and all these people who might come to town and talking about things that black people should be interested in. And my parents never, you know, said, well, your education is so you can escape into the white world. Our education was supposed to equip us to come back and help black people. I never intended to go into psychiatry. I thought when I was in medical school that Freudian psychoanalytic theory didn't make any sense. And indeed, I got into psychiatry by a fluke. That's a long story. But when I started training in psychiatry, they told us at St. Elizabeth's Hospital in Washington, D.C., 1963 to 1966, that black people didn't have the intelligence to benefit from psychotherapy. And the best treatment for black people was medication. Now, I'm a third generation physician. My dad was a physician. His father was a physician. That did not compute. There was nothing in our training that talked about racism, nothing in our training that talked about the mental health of black people. But whenever I talked to black people, there was always racism in history. You see, making us crazy. Always something about racism, but the training, all white training, you know, they were not interested in us. But I said, I've got to understand what is making black people mentally ill. And so I was pursuing that line of thinking on my own. And, you know, when you got a question in your mind, like when they say when the student is ready, the teacher appears. And when I was doing a fellowship in child psychiatry, 66 to 68 in Washington, at Children's Hospital, I would be seated, you know, sitting at my desk in the evening writing up cases. And I would get a voice, not in here, but in here, say, go to the Black Power Committee meeting. I mean, it would be in the evening, I'd be sitting in the office by myself. You know, and it wasn't frightening. It was nothing I had ever experienced before, but it was like a quiet. So then I thought I understood when somebody said they had a calling to go into ministry, what they might be talking about. But it would go to the Black Power Committee meeting. I didn't go to any meetings. Go to the Black Power Committee meeting. Go to the Black Power Committee. And so I finally went to a Black Power Committee meeting. That was in the 60s, and Stokely Carmichael, all those people were in D.C. from SNCC. And at a social, you know, like people going to somebody's house, somebody's apartment after a meeting, and people were sitting on the floor, and, you know, general conversation. Now, I'm a psychiatrist looking, what is the answer about racism? And I hear a black man over on the other side of the room say racism is a system. Now this black man was a guard at the Bureau of Engraving. Not a college graduate or anything. He had started writing about racism during the Korean War. He said he would be sitting on a radar site in Japan. And it just, you know, he said up on a mountain and it would be quiet. And he started thinking about what was going on in this part of the world and segregation and desegregation and thinking all that language didn't make any sense. And so he started thinking about racism, and he's the first person to say racism is a global system. Now I want every black person to master that understanding. It is essential to our future. See, we are taught, we are in a system of democracy or system of capitalism. Do you see? So we keep wondering, you know, it's like hitting our heads against a cement wall. But why is it that we're not moving forward? So Mr. Fuller said it is a system. And he said the system operates in all areas of people activity, economics, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war. Now that covers everything that we do. And he said the system is about maintaining the power equation of white over non-white. So I met him at this meeting, started talking to him. I said, this brother is really talking about something. And I'm looking as a psychiatrist for the answer. And then I meet him. And so then he would come over to my apartment and we would be yelling and screaming at each other. Till 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning. And I don't know how many of you know Dr. Carl Hutchinson. Dr. Hutchinson, he was training to be an orthopedic surgeon. He was a friend of mine. He's from Chicago, Roosevelt. And so then Carl, I'm not sure how Carl, but then it would be Carl, Neely Fuller, that's the gentleman's name, and myself, in my apartment, arguing all night. Mr. Fuller had a suitcase with about 1,800 pages. You know, notebook paper, three rings in it, orange suitcase, 300 precisely printed work. Carl Hutchinson said, I will type this material in between surgical cases. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So he took the 1,800 pages in his orange suitcase, precisely printed by Neely Fuller. And Carl typed up the whole thing. Carl is deceased. God bless him.
God bless him.
But that was monumental. And then if somebody told me, you're going to work with somebody 17 years to get their book published, I would never have believed it. But that was like 1967 to 1984. And so the book is now published, and anybody can call and get a copy from me at 202-484-5464. So I started saying, you know, as a psychiatrist, well, wait a minute. If this is a system, and it's local, national, and global, why? Why would such a system be set up on this planet? And Mr. Fuller used to say, Frances, it's not important why. Just learn the system. But it's like, I said, no, I got to find out why. See, because when you understand beyond what it is, and you understand why it is. See, little children, when they start asking why, they want to understand cause and effect. And if you can understand cause and effect, you can begin to deal with what it is. You have an in-depth understanding as to what it is. So I just started thinking about, you know, all those thousands of years of going to school. I just started thinking about what I had learned on this planet. This is planet Earth. And in this system, these people would call us minorities, right? That people of color are minorities, and they would say that we're genetic inferiors. And I said, well, wait a minute, but the reality is that 9/10 of the people on the planet are black, brown, red, and yellow. And we are not genetically inferior, we're genetically dominant. Mm-hmm. And somebody, well, what do you mean by that? And I say, Barack Obama. What? His mother was white. His father's black. The ability to produce this black pigment is a genetically dominant trait. The inability that is responsible for white skin is a genetic recessive trait. So I was actually standing in my kitchen in D.C. doing dishes or cooking. See, when you put a question, why is this happening? And if you put that question in your brain computer will pull in data. You see, that's why they would say the slave, yours is not to reason why. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're not supposed to think. Yours is but to do or die. Just don't think, let me, I'm the slave master, let me think. Let me tell you what to do. Don't you think, don't you be serious. So, we are the majority people on the planet, and we are genetically dominant. And so I said, okay, 15th century, Columbus started the white people coming out of Europe. And they went all over the planet, and everywhere they landed, it would be people of color. See, it was no more white people, just white people in this little tiny area. So go to look at the map, gigantic Africa, Asia, little tiny countries, look like a little beanie on the top of Africa. So they found out that the men had sexual relations with the women, and they waited around 9 months to repair boats, provision the ships, whatever. They found out that the children would all end up being colored. And so they didn't have to have a big conference. I'm sure they said. What if these men got in their boats and started going this way? They said white could disappear on the planet. Mm-hmm. See, now all of the stuff that is going on, all the furor about Barack Obama, is related to they're looking at that black man in the White House with that black wife and those black children and that black grandmother. And they are saying, what if the black people were in charge? Then we would disappear. I say, going back to Abraham Lincoln, emancipation of the enslaved African people, if he had said, you're free, no color distinctions, everybody just do their own thing, white people would have disappeared because of the genetic dominance of black. Mm-hmm. Now they understand that. Mm-hmm. I've given lectures and talked to white people, and I say, politely, do you want your children to be colored? Do you want your grandchildren to be colored? Do you want your great-grandchildren to be colored? Do you want your great-great-great-great-great-grandchildren? And what do they say?
No.
Make no mistake, no. Now you may see a lot of white women, white movie stars with little black babies. See, they're just letting that happen. You gotta look at the whole picture. That's happening simultaneously with thousands of black men being incarcerated. Thousands of black men who are unemployed. You see, so they understand what they are doing. Everything they do in economics, education, entertainment, labor law, politics, religion, sex, and war is for their genetic survival on this planet. Now, if you understand that, then you will understand racism is war against black people in general, but black men in particular. Why? See, why? Why the men?
Because they reproduce.
Mm-hmm.
They reproduce. We don't have nobody reproducing.
Because they can force. They can force
this
sexual.
It's going to be on the examination.
They can force sexual encounters.
It's because women, whether they're white, black, brown, red, or yellow, can entice a man to have sexual intercourse. She can't make him have sexual intercourse. In other words, if I went to my purse and pulled out a Uzi and I selected a man, I said, now you are going to have sexual intercourse. When he saw it was serious, he got frightened. What would happen, Joseph? Now what I'm saying, in other words, an erection cannot be maintained in the presence of fear. You see, now God forbid, men can impose sexual intercourse, but women cannot impose sexual intercourse. So if indeed I am correct in saying that this is about white genetic survival, to prevent white genetic annihilation. Mm. By any
means necessary.
See, if you turn on History Channel, see, white people are arming themselves.
Yes.
They have all kinds of weapons. We have been put in a situation where black people can't get weapons. All they have to do is, they've got a whole system set up. Unemployment, and then people might start selling drugs or whatever, then you get a record, then you can't vote, and then you can't buy weapons. So, see, they understand completely what they are doing while we are dancing and singing, sometimes praying. You see, but praying to who? A white image of God. See, they got their system wrapped up tight. You can give them an A+. See, when I was a little girl, my grandfather was chairman of the Deacon and Trustee Board at Albert Baptist Church. We were in church before we could see straight. And I remember the little Sunday school card with the white Jesus kneeling down, purple and white robe on. And so I remember looking at this, you look at it every Sunday on the Sunday school card. And so in our house, we had a pantry. And on the first shelf, you know, where you could have the tall items, it was always right there in the middle was a big box of Quaker Oats. I had some Quaker Oats this morning. A big box of Quaker Oats. So I remember going and looking at that. I don't know whether I was 5 or something. And I looked at this white man on the, you know, the white man with the Quaker hat and the long white hair. And so I decided, oh, I guess that's Jesus' father. I mean, it wasn't something I discussed with my parents. I had concluded that on my own. Well, that must be Jesus has got that long blonde hair. And here's an older man, white. They didn't look like the people on the south side of Chicago. But I said, I guess that's not. Now, everybody, whether you're aware of it or not, when that image implant of Jesus, the Son of God, when that goes into the brain, your brain has to conclude that God is white.
Right.
See, he couldn't be black. Otherwise, how could Jesus come out white? Now, I don't know how many people saw the news week for a couple of weeks ago, 2 weeks ago or a week ago. It says something about forget the church, follow Jesus. And it had an image of a blind white man. Jesus. Now see, when you got the image of God, the same image of the person who oppresses you, then they have you do a musical, Arms Too Short to Box with God. Arms Too Short to Box with the white man. Do you all understand? See, but there are little clues. See, the truth always surfaces. I tell people at my institute that if you look at the word Jesus in Ebonics, you get just us. Now, Jesus was black if he came from that part of the world. He was a black man. Even Billy Graham said Jesus could not have been white. You see, but we don't want him if he's not white.
Right. That's right.
See, that's just like the word America. See, things are hidden in words. Mm-hmm. The phrase, I am race. I-A-M-R-A-C-E. I am race. Sitting right there in those words. Now let's just go a little bit further. See, everything that takes place in a system structure, see, this is the power dynamic. So everything that takes place in here is related to the system. Everything. Everything that takes place in here. One day I was leaving the clinic and it was some young black people walking by and they were saying, motherfucker, the motherfucker, the motherfucker, the motherfucker, this and the motherfucker. And so I thought to myself, first thought, why are the children talking like this? Second thought, if this word is used with such high frequency, it must have significance beyond just something that people are uttering. So I go back to the system structure. And I say, in this system, there are five people categories. Man, woman, boy, girl, baby. If I said, here comes the man, you all, would you expect to see my father? Wake up, class. I said, the man. Who is the man?
The white man.
Come on, class. The white man. See, it's the truth that is going to set us free. We're in a mess.
Yes,
we are in a genocide slide because if somebody is trying to have genetic survival and prevent genetic annihilation, they will destroy the people who are the threat to their genetic survival. So we got to get down to the truth. So if the man is the white man, any other male has four choices. Woman, boy, girl, baby. How many black men in the past lost their lives? Don't call me no boy. Is that right? The boy's life. Until recently, woman and girl were out. The baby. How many black women have called a black man baby? Let's see if she'll have a picture. How many black men have called a black woman mama? Come on, you all. This is Liberation Saturday. All right. many gentlemen have called a place where they sleep a crib.
Popular one.
See, the brain is just
a logic
machine. So man who calls another man the man, that means the only one, that's the isolating argument, calls himself baby, calls the woman he sleeps with mama, calls a place where he sleeps a crib. Well, what? Call himself a motherfucker. Are you all with me?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
All of this is because of the system. In other words, this means the only person with power are white men. See, you know, if we can just get over the fear of the truth.
Yes.
See, it's like if I had my way, if I had Oprah's money, I would have a national conference. And the conference would be, I would pay the black men, have a conference to say, we are afraid of the white man.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Now, see, some people might think, oh, that sounds, no. The white man is afraid of the black man.
That's right.
The white man is afraid of genetic annihilation. The black man doesn't even have to have a gun. Just with his genetic material, he can cause white genetic annihilation. But instead of talking about fear, he puts into play, stand your ground. Are you all familiar with that?
Yes.
That means all white man, Mr. Zimmerman, all he has to do is say, I was afraid.
That's it.
And that will be called justifiable homicide. See, my little bet is on, will Mr. Zimmerman get off?
Yes.
Mr. Zimmerman will get off. See, they first reported that Mr. Zimmerman was white, then they started calling him Hispanic.
Mm-hmm.
Hispanic doesn't have a color.
That's right.
Right. I'm sure he checked white on the census. His father is white. You see, so he was standing his ground. The reason that the police let him go was because they all have that mindset.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm not going to stop. I'm going to pursue him.
Mm-hmm.
And the next thing we hear is Trayvon calling for help.
Mm-hmm.
And the next thing we hear, the gunshots.
Mm-hmm.
And Trayvon is dead. And Mr. Zimmerman walks.
Mm-hmm.
See, stand your ground laws are now in 26 states.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, let me just go further with this. See, I say human life began in Africa. Everybody knows that, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so the black people are the parents of everybody on the planet.
That's right.
Even the white people, because white people are a genetic mutation to albinism from black people. Black people are the only people who can produce all of the colors. So I say that black people put the albinos out. How many people have read articles about the Africans mistreating the albinos, killing them? Now that's what the black people, wait a minute, there's something wrong with these people with no pigmentation. Push them out. That's what the Adam and Eve story is about. Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, they ate the forbidden fruit and became ashamed of their nakedness, their absence of color. And they were chased out of the Garden of Eden. And that's how they ended up in Europe. So I say that what they did was organize themselves many thousands of years, and then they came back to Africa, and they got us. I call it white reparations.
Yeah.
So See, they came and got us and said, okay, you black people, you're going to work for us. You're going to put that black baby out of the box in the field and nurse this white baby. And you're going to work and clean for us, and we're going to beat you like every child who has ever been given away by their parents. See, we see stories about all the happy reunion. That lasts for about 2 weeks. And then it hits the child. You gave me up. And what does the child want to do to her parents?
Show me.
Do you all understand?
I understand.
So like I tell people in my office, you know, we are the parents of everybody on the planet. We're white people's parents. When I first told the white people that, I said, you know, maybe we as black people owe you all an apology. Maybe we were the first abusing parents because we gave you up because you didn't look right. You were mutants. And I say, that's why you have Uncle Ben's rice and Jemima. See, those are relatives feeding you. They call the black woman mammy. They call the white woman who takes care of children a nanny. Right?
Right.
And that's why Oprah Winfrey's program was so successful. See, honey, baby, tell mammy.
Yep.
One day Shirley MacLaine was talking to Oprah about, Oprah was saying she wanted to lose weight. And Shirley MacLaine had just jumped out of her mouth, if you lose weight, you lose your show. Because who wants a skinny mammy? Now she didn't say that last time. You see, but she became what? The most successful woman in TV. See, all of this is the underlying subconscious that is going on in this system. Even ball games. Do ball games have anything to do with racism and white supremacy?
Yes.
I mean, don't answer if you read the book. Let people who haven't read the book answer. A white man came to my lecture last week in D.C. So I was asking him, I said, you know, one white man sitting in the middle of all these black people. But he had four black people as his protectors. And I asked him, I said, what are the two series of ball games in the system of racism and white supremacy? See, people are looking at ball games all the time. People go to ball games, pay attention to ball games more so than religion. Every season has a ball game. So you keep looking at balls, right? Now what did I say about what the problem on the planet? The problem on the planet is this. Now that's not a man with glasses. In other words, the fear of genetic annihilation, this is just a schematic view drawn by a physician of male genitalia. These are called testicles. What's in the testicles? The genetic material. Colloquially, they are called what, gentlemen?
Balls.
Balls. Is that right? Am I making anything up? See, I don't make stuff up. I just listen to the culture. Listen to what the culture is saying. So now, class, what are the two series of ball games in a system of racism, white supremacy.
Basketball, football,
pool, baseball.
Somebody's coming back for summer school. See, you're looking at it all the time.
It's cool.
But because you're told this is a democracy, you don't see it. See, it's what are you told, and that becomes the frame in which you look at things. Mm. Once you understand that the frame is a system of racism, white supremacy, you will begin to see things differently. So we're looking at the two series of ball games all the time. And this comes out of the white brain computer. The two series are big brown balls and small white. Are you all with me?
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I could say marbles, but I'll start. Ping pong, golf, tennis. What are the big brown?
Basketball.
Okay, now, what do white women say? White women say their ideal mate is who?
Tall, dark.
Tall, dark.
That's right.
And handsome. So, we see in these two games, the football, white, two white upright legs at the end of the field.
Mm-hmm.
Are you with me, class?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Basketball, white net. The psychiatrists will say these are symbols of the female vaginal orifice. And then you see white ladies in short skirts dancing on the side. Black girls can hardly get on the pitch. What's the game played by the most powerful white men?
Golf.
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 Golf. Golf.
Golf.
That's probably why Tiger had to be killed. Because he doesn't understand. Okay, golf. Long stick held between legs, right? Trying to knock a little white ball where? In what
hole?
Like Mother Earth. See, white men say they're not men until they've had sexual intercourse with a black woman. And so the game of golf, if you all are a mature class, I can take you to advanced level understanding. Are you all with me? Okay, the golf game, the ball can either go in the rough or it can go in the water. Or it can go in the hole. Now the female vaginal area, or the sand trap. So the sand trap would be equivalent to the anus. The hole would be the vagina. And the water would be the urethra. See, all of this is symbolic material coming out in the brain, dealing with a survival. See, white people are dealing with their survival. They are not playing. See, they teach us play. Clown, play, clown. We will be serious. And I say that's why as one-tenth of the people on the planet, there's only one-tenth people on the planet who are white. But they appear very powerful because they are all focused on how they classify themselves. See, they don't call themselves Euro-American. They call themselves white. Now they tell us, call yourself African American. So you're not even focused. See, what color are we? See how quiet?
Be caffeinated.
We are black, in shades of black. But as long as we are running from this, there's an African proverb that says, when the fool learns the game, the players have the first. See, in other words, we have been completely deceived about what is really going on. And so this is what we absolutely must change. Our children must be helped to understand. See, black people will say, do I have to tell my child about racism? Yeah. I don't know how many of you saw Anderson Cooper's program on children and rapes. A 3-year-old white child knows, if he looks at a series of faces and they go from white to black, the 3-year-old white child without hesitation, which child is ugly? Black. Which child is dumb? Black. Which child do you not want to be friends with? Black. Now the tragedy is that when black children are asked the same questions, they answer just like the white child. You have a beautiful black child saying, I don't like the color because it's nasty. See, in other words, we are learning racism, white supremacy. Hate black, admire white, wish you were white. Oh God, why did you make me black? They are focused. So with 1/10 of the people on the planet, they can control the whole planet because they have figured out those little trips all around the globe, seeing as colored people everywhere, they're genetically dominant to us. What do we have to do? See, we have to be in charge, and the people that we have to be in charge of most. And black people learn it before we learn how to read. If you are black, what?
Stand back.
If you are brown, stick around. If you're yellow,
you're mellow.
And if you're white, you're all right. Now you go to London and go through the same thing and the people answer. Black people. This is non-white people understand this all over the world. So the 9/10 have been taught to hate color. Black is the greatest genetic potential to cause white genetic annihilation. And so this has to be most feared. These are just different levels of melanin pigment production. Now white people understand this, and this is why when somebody brings up race, they start screaming, you're playing a race car. Thou shalt not be a race hustler. See, all of the things that they say, President Obama, he's not an American. He's not a Christian. Translate, he's not white. See, just over and over again. Now, they understand the discussion. See, while we're, well, I don't like him myself.
Right.
See, it's no black person who could be in his situation who would be doing anything differently, because they have shown Brother Barack. When they let the lady in the red dress come into the White House.
Yeah, right.
Look, buddy, we'll let anybody in here that we want to let in. Do you get it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You can be killed anytime we want. Now, you got a
right.
nice wife,
mm-hmm.
right? And some pretty little children.
Yes.
They can be gone and you can be gone. So you don't believe it? We'll give you Act Two. Columbia.
Mm-hmm.
See, there's no way in the world
mm-hmm.
that all those Secret Service people and Army people acting together.
Yeah.
See, I say no. What they were doing, get his attention. Make him think this is a big deal. And then have him set up his little investigation. And when he thinks everything has been taken care of, we will take care of him.
Mm-hmm.
Do you all understand? In other words, we're dealing with people who understand what they're doing.
Yes, ma'am.
They are talking about their survival on the planet. Now, black people, you dance. Keep shaking booty.
Right.
Keep looking at those TV programs with black people.
Right.
Clowning and acting buffoon.
Right.
Now that's what we want you to do.
Mm-hmm.
Clown, buffoon, buffoon, and clown. And I would like to be wrong. But see, following this, what would seal the election? Assassinate him.
Mm-hmm.
And then have the black people rioting.
Mm-hmm.
And then put the black people in those prisons and everything Patriot Act that they got set up.
Mm-hmm.
See, so we have to come out of pettiness. I don't like him.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, the game is about race.
Man.
See, he even said, well, we need to have dialogue about race. Then the Attorney General said, are we a nation of cowards?
That's what he said.
Being unable to talk about race.
Mm-hmm.
And the powers that be made both of them shut up.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not going to be talking about race. You're not going to be revealing what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So you boys better shut up.
Mm-hmm.
I know you're supposed to be president, and I know you're supposed to be attorney general. This is a white supremacy system.
Mm-hmm.
See, they were showing him, your advance team, people who are supposed to protect you. Buddy, you don't have any
protection.
Based on our decision making. See, in other words, this, what is that game? White genetic survival by any means necessary. Now, what should black people understand from this? See, it is time for black people to be serious, and I'm not talking about running around. We hate white people.
Mm.
Forget it.
This is white.
It's not about hating white people. It's not about being rude and disrespectful to them. It's like a chess game.
Mm-hmm.
White side of the board, black. What's the object of the game of chess?
Captain King. Queen.
I'm gonna give you a B.
Mm-hmm. You're trying to get one all one color to the other side.
Queen.
Yeah, trying to get one to
the
side.
Going down. Checkmate.
Checkmate.
The queen.
Yeah.
Right.
See.
Destroy the queen.
In the game of chess, who moves first?
White
always moves first. White is playing offense, defense. Defense, that's offense, that's what you play by white. The object of the game is for the white king to checkmate the black king. Understand?
Yes, ma'am.
From Trayvon to Martin Luther King and all of the people in America. If we checkmate him, we can make their whole thing collapse. We can make every male child confused. I see little children, male children. A child says to me, Dr. Welsing, you know, all the little boys brought to the psychiatrist because they won't work in school. Little child says, Dr. Welsing, I think I can do my homework if I just had an official father. Now, when a child says that, the psychiatrist wants to fall under the desk in tears. Another child said to me, if I had a father, he could at least have taught me what goes on under the hood of a car. Now, these are people 10, 11. See, all these little boys that are acting up, these are children that are traumatized. They're children who are depressed. And children get depressed. Where is my father? See, I'm not saying the fathers are bad. White supremacy said, I'll put you in check. I'm going to put you in check. Because I have to do it for white genetic survival. See, now we have to understand what is being played on this field? What is being played on this power field? And we have to decide, well now let's see, what are we going to do about it? See, we're not going to spend any energy, time hating white people. That's what they want us to do. We did that. Been there, done that. Hungry, been there, done that. See, what I would like them to feel is, I don't know what's happening to the black people. They're so quiet. And they're so serious. Anybody working in an office, as long as the black people are cackling over the corner, throwing chicken bones on the floor.
It's crazy.
Everything is fine. But let the black people go to the water cooler and start talking quietly. White person, is there anything I need to know about it?
Right.
No, black people should get serious. Serious. I see a young black man, and he was on a job. And the white men would say, how come you have to have shine shoes every day? Now, can you imagine a black man saying something like that to a white man?
No.
Why are your shoes shined every day? How come you don't dress down? Just talk to a guy from New Orleans. He said the people on his job, he works engineer with those, what, the levees? And he was just telling me last week, he said, I go to work, Dr. Welsing, with a bow tie and a shirt and slacks. White guy, how come you gotta have a tie on? Why don't you dress down? I told him, I said, because you look like the supervisor. And they can't stand that. See, they start getting nervous. Wait a minute, who does he think he is? Now, he's not trying to show off. He's just, these are my work clothes. Why can't I wear this to work if I want to wear this to work? You see, but they are always on the case, nervously on the case. Now, let me go back to this important diagram. Front view of male genitalia, lateral view. Turn this around 90 degrees and you have this. What does that look like?
A gun.
What do they call a gun?
This
great Equalizer. In other words, you can annihilate me with your genetic material. Must create weapon, can do same thing. That's the gun. You see what I'm saying? Which is why they have a law, stand your ground. Because of black people, the people of color are getting ready to be the majority between the Hispanics and the blacks. And so white supremacy, what do? Well, we get heavily armed and then we put this law in place. See, now for people who think this couldn't happen, see, in Washington, D.C., we have a Holocaust Memorial Museum. Now, that was a museum dedicated to what happened to the Semites, the Jewish religion in Europe. If you read Hitler's work, Hitler said, I don't care about their religion. I'm not interested in their religion. They are not white. See, now, I don't care how white they look. You see, we got tons of black people that can pass for white. So Hitler said, what I'm going to make you do is you're going to have to put on a yellow star on your outer garment so that I can identify you. Yeah. You call it a yellow hoodie if you want.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so anybody who had that yellow star on their clothing could be beat up in the street, could be killed, their stores could be destroyed. You see, now the Jewish people don't want to think back and call themselves non-white. They want to be in the white group now. You see, but you still got Nazis and white supremacists going around talking about destroying them here. So I'm just saying, this was state sanctioned. Democratic so-called state that said these people, it's too many of them. How many people have been reading the stories coming out of Europe? Too many immigrants. Islam. See, they use, you know, the Germans talked about Jews. So you think religion. No, they were talking about color in the same way. In the rest of Europe, they're talking about color. The Norwegian guy that just killed 70-something people. The majority of them were children from African and Asian backgrounds. Just got a gun and mowed down 70. And said, you know, I did it. I'm not sorry. Sorry, I couldn't kill more. So the point is that we have to, as I said, forget hate. We have to understand and say, this is why we greet each other. Hey, what's happening? What's happening? Hey, what's happening? What's happening? Because we don't know what's going on. See, the brain keeps raising. What's happening? What's happening? What's happening is a system of racism, white supremacy, for white genetic survival. See, none of this is new. This is just the extension of lynching and castrating black men. Killing at will. You see, now I can feel the vibe. See, it's painful for us to think about this. It is painful for us because our whole thing from the civil rights era on was, well, we should all love Rodney King. Can't we all just get along? Do you see, but if the goal objective is white genetic survival, if you take Dr. King, he's a brilliant soldier, sociologist, minister. So he said everybody should love. But what would happen on a planet if one-tenth is recessive and the nine-tenths are dominant? And everybody just put a heart around it. Love. The white is going to disappear, and the white people understand that. See, they understand. A white person told me it's time for me to shut up. A white, see, sometimes white people say, Dr. Welsing, how can I help? And I say, tell black people what white people talk about when there's no black people around. See, what do you all talk about when none of us are around? See, God forbid if a black person is in bed with a white person and a black person in the middle of the sex act. What are y'all talking about? The sex act will stop. See, because in other words, you're talking about survival.
Yes, ma'am.
I gave a talk in Baltimore 2 weeks ago. Black man came up and, you know, basically discussion about race. So this black man came up and he said, well, Dr. Welsing, I'm married to a white woman and I have three sons. And I said, is your wife in the John Brown movement? See, think about all the white people who are in bed with black people as we speak. Do they have an organized movement to stop the white people who are planning to hurt black people?
No.
See, American University professor, female. American University had an education program for the black prisoners in Lorton. And so I was invited to come and talk. And I talked to all these black men in prison about racism. So this white lady was driving me home. And so because, see, when you speak truth to them, it makes them open up their mouths. Like a white banker said to me, I gave a talk in the, you know, in the 70s, I guess, when they had, you know, a black speaker and a white bank. I gave this talk. And this banker said, came up, you know, white face, silver hair, $1,000 suit, shook my hand. He said, Dr. Welsing, you're right about what you're saying. But what can you do about it? I said, we'll just have to see. The white professor, she said, Dr. Welsing, I hate to admit it, but on all social occasions, she didn't say occasionally. She said on all social occasions, when white people get together and there's no black people around, she said, we are talking negatively about black people. And the assumption is that everybody in the room is in agreement. I didn't make her say it. I said, no, I understand. See, you all are talking code. Code for white genetic survival. That means that we have to paint the black people as the demons. If you look at TV long enough, Trayvon Martin is the aggressor.
That's right.
And Lil Zimmerman, he didn't do nothing but try to protect himself. Every white person understands that. You don't understand. We have to of looking at and understanding the world. If we value ourselves, if we value ourselves, see, and so everybody can take the test on their own. How much do I hate Crystal Black? See how quiet you are. See, little babies know. You know, first day of life, family goes and is looking at the little babies. The nurse said, this one is yours. Must be a problem here. That can't be ours. Are you all with me?
Yes,
yes, ma'am.
Yes,
see, we hate Black. We have been taught to hate Black. See, and I think the Creator created Black. That's the only, that's all energy is Black. So the Creator said, I made you Black. You don't even know what Black can do. Black can lift up those stones to build pyramids.
That's right.
You don't even have a clue because you don't want to be Black. So glad the grandparents got raped. See, think about it. Yeah. See, the white people look at us and they say, we got that one. Our boys got that grandma. Then we got two grandmothers here. See, now that doesn't mean hate any of the colors. But see, our brain has been turned completely upside down. And our brain is not functioning. Brains are not functioning for our best interest. And we have to go back. See, it's okay to be wrong. We were, you know, we thought when we were enslaved, just take off the chains.
Yeah.
If you take off the chains, everything is going to be okay. So the chains were taken off, and the next thing we, well, they got these laws. So we struggle with the laws called the Civil Rights Era. And white people said, fine, we'll change the laws. But we're going to hire some of their so-called musicians. And we're going to do some psychological warfare on these people the likes of which they've never seen. Because they don't know what we're doing. So as long as we give the musicians some jewelry and about 15 cars apiece. And we will have them train their people. See, if you look at the Black people in the Civil Rights Movement, when those people went up against dogs and horses and being beaten, and they were walking in dignity and talking about Black is beautiful. Black pride, Black dignity, Black self-respect. And the white people said, we gotta get rid of this. And since they don't understand what we're doing, we can sock it to them. We don't give them super fly, get drugs, get guns. And then we're gonna start training them to call themselves niggers and say it's a term of endearment. And call themselves gangsters and thugs and dogs and bow wows, bitches and hoes. Now, if they ever recover, see, if people can take you where you gonna call yourself a nigger, a bitch, and a hoe, and a dog. Let's give them some more AIDS. Imagine when they get together. These people are so bricked up.
Yeah.
are the dumbest people on this planet. We can do anything. There's an African proverb that says, the monkey was so busy doing what everybody else was doing that one day, monkey cut his throat. See, that's some deep stuff in some of those African proverbs. See, monkey see, monkey do. What you doing today, white people? Oh, sex with dogs. Ooh, goody, give me some of that.
Whatever they do.
You see, so I see the creator. Black is a trillion midnights. Eyes shining brighter than a billion suns. Whose hair doth coil tighter than a million springs, radiating all energy throughout the universe. We beseech thee, one and only one, to give us total strength to carry out thy will for the universe, to establish justice and live in peace. You see, now, when the white people say if somebody knows about God, what do they put on?
Robe.
Black.
Black robe.
If they know about justice,
black robe.
You don't see any judge who's supposed to know about justice sitting up in a white robe. If you are supposed to have attained wisdom, you put on a black cap and gown. When the white people consider that they are maximally dressed, black. See, and when they have those tails, that's this. Are you all with me?
Yes, ma'am.
See, we don't know what black can do. George Washington Carver was crystal black. They called him a wizard. And they say, how do you do what you do? He said, I go out in the quiet of the morning. And the plants tell me what they can do. See, he's just talking about melanin. Black is a superior absorber of energy. So he's going out there when it's quiet and he can pick up the frequency and translate it. It's like a plant. It's just like our eyes, our sense perceptors. But we're so busy hating black. You see, but let's give him another. See, but it's okay. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. Because we're going to come out of this stupid state. See, the white people are not going to help us. They can't help us. You see, nobody who is afraid of other people's ability to genetically annihilate through making so-called love, they're not going to maximally develop us. They're not going to maximally develop our children. That's the last thing they have in mind. They're not going to maximally develop us. See, we have to change our concept of what black is. See, don't call yourself Afro-Americans. Call yourself black. Black. See, the white people say, I'm black. See, but the little children tell on us because I'm mixed race. Now the children sound crazy, but it's because the parents are crazy. See, every black person is mixed race. A white man was doing so much raping. Mixed. You know, black people filling out the census. Let's see. I think I got some French. The white people just check. White!
Yeah.
And they finish that. And we're, I think I got, well, let's see. That grandmother said, hey, Irish.
Irish, yes.
See, black people started saying Indian because it was embarrassing to know that the slave master had raped somebody. And so they got long, straight hair. So the black people, no, I'm part Indian. No, you were raped. Now, this is not for us to hate each other, hate ourselves. We have to embrace ourselves.
Mm.
Everybody hug yourself right now. I love myself. I mean, I truly love myself. And I thank the Creator.
And I thank you.
For giving me the courage. To talk about difficult subjects. See, this discussion is the most difficult subject. But it is the most necessary subject. That we need to engage in. Now I'm going to talk about one more thing. So what do we do on our side of the chessboard? See, now black people, oh, we can't do nothing about racism. No, I just wanted to say this. Like you tell a black man, this is how you play football. It's a game of strategy and tactics based on understanding the game. And nobody outplays it. Tactics and strategy. What is the game? How is it played? And I'll even invent tactics and strategies. Nothing wrong with the brain. The only thing that's wrong with us is that under white supremacy, we want white people to love us. Because we are deficient in loving ourselves. Okay, I gotta stop you.
Okay, we're gonna take a quick break. I know y'all got cold, so we're gonna cut the air off. Matter of fact, cut the air off. We're gonna take a quick break. Why don't you go out and get some food? I know y'all hungry. Now, the breakdown, I love it. This is what attracted me to the whole concept, the breakdown, the actual concept. But, we'll be back. We're going to continue the presentation in 20 minutes.